there YouTubers, and welcome to this T4D. Now, I hadn't realized I'd be slotting in this T4D this quickly because the Solar Power International show is on in Las Vegas. Now, I hadn't realized it was on. I was approached by an Italian company called HT Instruments. They've got some instruments. They do multimeters, solar power analyzers, thermal images. And they tapped me on the shoulder and said, look, by the way, we'd like to be able to send you some equipment for review, but we will be at the show, the Solar Power International show in October, which is on between the 20th and 23rd. So next week, this time, literally. So I suddenly realized, hello, this is something that I should be attending. So anyway, I've gone and managed to get flights, book hotels, and I've managed to get a press pass. So we're going to talk a bit more about that at the end of this video. I will be there next week. I'm going to be filming bits and pieces. Then also in this T4D, I'm going to talk a little bit about the solar module analyzer that I've got from Isotech. I really do like some aspects of the solar power analyzer. And there's something called fill factor I just want to bring to your attention and talk about. And I'll quickly tell you about the Wago connectors I've been using with connecting up my solar power system. And then there is a new cell to be tested from A123 Systems batteries. They've got a new cell which is rechargeable, which I claim has got higher energy density. I also met some interesting folks at our last meetup. One in particular is Rick Pollack. Now, he's the gent who formed and founded MakerGear 3D printers, and they've got the M2 3D printer. Really nice gent. There's a support chap that works for him as well, though it was at the meetup. Very nice chatting to them. It looks like they've got a nice 3D printer. 3D printing, I don't know much about, but there was another gent there who brought along what he had done on a 3D printer was an enclosure. Beautifully done on his first attempt, and they offered to actually create the enclosure for my power supply project. So that could be really interesting. We could introduce it to their 3D printer and see how well it works, going to the 3D design for an enclosure. There's two options with the enclosure. One is 3D printing it, or actually laser cutting it out of plywood. So that's the other option. So let's just talk a little bit about the Solar Power International Convention. I'm going to be flying out on Monday next week to go to that. It runs from the 20th to the 23rd. I hope to get 2 full days at the expo. Now, my hope for there is for one, to meet the gent from HT Instruments, and then the other is to try and look at new solar power technologies. I've gone and realized that with my solar power installation that I've done, there are still, even though that Outback inverter is a great inverter with lots of functionality, there are still quite a few limitations. Some of those I'm finding, I mentioned the term grid zero, where in theory you could set it so you don't push energy back onto the grid, but it'll use a combination of your renewable energy and grid energy to run your home. And there's some interesting nuances there where things don't quite hook together that well. Also, hooking up lithium battery technologies to any solar power installation still is a bit of a nightmare at the moment. That's why I have a lot of respect for Dayton and the work he's done in terms of his solar charger and being able to charge a bank of lithium batteries. I know Dan Fredrickson posted something about high power batteries. I've been chatting to them. I'm trying to get a cell to test, and I'm seriously looking at getting my own lithium battery bank together. But the challenges of getting one together and getting the right charging system and cell balancing system together is not easy. And that's something I'm hoping to see whether at the show anyone has produced anything that's consumer ready in that regard. And then a good gent, Dean, posted a comment on one of the last videos. He works in the solar power industry in South Africa. There's a company called Solar Frontier. We've got a CIS thin film solar module. And apparently they are outperforming silicon modules. So I've been in touch with them. I'm trying to get hold of one so that I can do a side-by-side with another panel. At the moment, their panel is about 170 watts, so I want to do a side-by-side with another 170 watt panel to see how well they work. And then the other thing I want to see at the show is whether anyone has actually produced a solar panel, an AC solar panel with an integrated inverter. So those are the things I'm going to be keeping an eye open for, and I'm going to take my cameras, obviously film the things that I find interesting. But if there's anything in particular that you want me to keep an eye open for, then do post in the comments below. And if I do happen to come across that and it's interesting, then I'll certainly film it and bring it to you guys. The next thing, I'm going to take you into the back. I have now just gone and cleaned up, cleared up, finished the installation. It's all nice and clean. So before I go and start connecting test equipment to the solar power installation inside, I'll show you it. I'm going to also show you where I think I could have done things a little bit better. So these will be lessons that you can take away if you're going to do this kind of thing yourself. and then the potential issue where I've used two conduits to carry the cabling to the grid side and to then the sub panel side.
So here we go. This is the system where it's all cleaned up. I've gone and removed all the tools, cleaned everything. I've gone and added covering over the wiring where I can. So like the big DC cabling, which goes down to the battery bank, I've got that covered up. The conduit that I've got going up to the main breaker box, I've tied that onto the sideboard so it's nice and firm. There's no risk of it kind of being wiggled and stress being placed on where it goes into the actual breaker box. I'm going to talk about in a moment the two conduits here and the issues that that can potentially raise, which was an education for me. But first of all, this conduit, it's watertight conduit, it's UL rated, and the code says you can use this outdoors because it is watertight and it is used for direct burial. So just a note, but always check your local codes to see if that is the case. Then at the top, I've got that box where I'm connecting the circuits. So the few circuits that I'm running through the house, I've got about 6 to 8 circuits, which I'm running off the system. So I'm able to back them up, obviously, with the battery power and then run them from the solar panels outside. But I had to pull them out. The wiring was obviously too short to get back to the other sub panel. So you do need to, if you are going to join wires together, you do need to have them in an enclosure. Where they enter the enclosure, you also need to have a clamp so that there's no strain on the where you join them. And I used those Wago or Wago connectors, which were a godsend. Really, really nice connectors. I can highly recommend them. So that's been done. And then on the side where they come in, I tied them together and then I got some wrapping just to make it a little bit neater so that there's not a kind of spaghetti nest of wires going over the top. So that's all tied together. Then coming back to the issue of using two conduits. Now I used two because I had bought 1/2 inch conduit for another application and I didn't want to waste it. And in hindsight, that's one of the things I would certainly not do in the future. It would be far neater and nicer to have, let's say, the 3/4 inch, and it's 6 gauge wiring. So it is heavy gauge wiring, which is going between the two panels. And at best, I could only get 3 into that 1/2 inch, whereas if I had 3/4 inch, I could get all of them. Now, initially when I did this, I actually carried the two lives in the one and the earth and the neutral in the other, because it gave a lot more space as I was using the two conduits. But there's an issue with doing that. If you've got your lives and then a separation where you're going into an enclosure and your neutral in the other, you've got your AC going back and forth, and it's like a transformer. You induce flux or currents in the actual metal between. Now, I don't think the risk is shock, but what can happen apparently is you can actually end up heating through that flux and the AC flowing with this little separation. You can actually end up heating the enclosure. So that's the risk. So then what I did was I pulled the neutral out of this. I've only got an earth flowing in the one, and then I've got my live and my neutrals all flowing in the other. So that's just a little gotcha, which you wouldn't readily realize, is don't have that separation because it can induce currents in the metal enclosure. Now, one of the things I noted and the reason I went for this Outback is that it does have a lot of features, things like it can be run in a backup mode, in a UPS mode, grid zero mode, a mini grid mode. And I'm experimenting with that because, as I said, I'm finding some limitations with those configurations, things which aren't highlighted in the manual. What Outback don't really cater well for is placing other manufacturers' equipment, or in particular, let's say, grid-tied microinverters on your solar panels. They don't have any of their own products at the moment, and those don't interface well with the system. As I noted, there's that fudge where you've got the remotely operated circuit breaker to switch off the panels if the batteries are going to overcharge. There are certain issues with the grid zero setup. So I've called their support, very helpful folk on the other side, and they've admitted there are these limitations, and those are things I'm going to investigate and highlight in due course. The other thing I'm going to do is that this Envoy gateway, although it's a nice device, it's not really real time in terms of the power output from the solar panels. So I'm going to start experimenting. I want to understand exactly where the power is going and have energy monitoring. So I'm going to use my Fluke 43B to monitor the energy that comes in from the solar panels. I'm going to get another device to see what is pulled in from the grid, just to see where everything's going so I can monitor the performance of the system. And that's something I say I'll talk about in future videos.
And I mentioned these kind of Wago connectors. Now, I obviously did a quick tech video where I did the push-in type, but these are brilliant because they've got the levers on them which can open up, easily slide the wires in and then close them. So you can easily pull, open up the lever and remove wiring if you need to. And if you're in a tight spot, it is so easy in comparison to, let's say, using one of those connector blocks with the screws, having to try and use a screwdriver and hold wiring in at the same time. You simply slot the wire in and snap it closed. What a joy. I know they are more expensive than certainly wire nuts, but for the job that I was doing, they were a godsend. Then the other thing I just want to mention, I'm going to do a separate video review on this Isotech solar module analyzer. I went and bought a mega irradiance meter. For one, I don't have one, and it's quite handy for, let's say, lining up your solar panels to see that where, what angle they get in the best sun, to have a measurement of the amount of sun that you're getting. And in particular, if you're trying to do efficiency measurements, you need to have irradiance and also the area of the solar panel. So the one thing I just want to mention to you, because I had not heard of before, and that's something called fill factor. Now, fill factor is another measurement you can get from solar panels, and it is a very useful one. And I had not heard of it before until I started looking into the solar module analyzer and seeing how it worked. So I will demonstrate fill factor and how it can be a very useful parameter for understanding the health and performance of solar panels, other than the normal, let's say, efficiency tests. Part two of the solar power video will be released soon. I'll be off at the conference next week. I'm going to try and fit in another video before then if possible, but if not, I'll then obviously have footage from the conference which will be released before the end of the month. Thanks very much for your support, and I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.